somewhere between afternoon and evening. Welcome to our guest lecture today, and after that, it's a double header tonight, the larger book presentation. I'm Florian Schwartz, for those of you who don't know me yet, director of the Institute of Iranian Studies, and it's not only a great honor, but a real privilege and real pleasure to have a very distinguished guest here, Martin Schwartz from the University of California, Berkeley. I'm very, very glad that you accepted our invitation to come here, to stop by the Institute and give a lecture while traveling in Central Europe, I think, these days. Martin Schwartz hardly needs an introduction. Principal voices, I could say, of Iranian studies, especially poetry, and with Iranian languages and literatures, Iranian, Indo-European philology, historical linguistics, and very generally old and with Iranian studies in their relations to the wider context of the ancient world of late antiquity, something where he brings to full also his expertise, for example, in Semitic languages, for example, Arabic, which is not necessarily everyone works in this particular field, is as you are. What I always find striking is the very wide thematic range of publications, very often starting from very particular philological observations and then tying them into wider questions of religious history. One thing that maybe not everyone in this room is aware of is the fact that Martin has a reputation as a specialist in in an international revival of klezmer music. So that's also something that we should be very grateful to him for. But here now we are to listen to you for your talk on Zarathustra's Yima and Ferdowsi's Jamshid, Poetics, Linguistics, Mythology, and Memory. Please, Martin. Great to have you here.
Thank you so much, Florian, for that most kind introduction and for the invitation, which I'm very glad to accept to be here. And I'll start, ladies and gentlemen. My subject is a most multifaceted figure of Iranian myth, Avest Yima, the Persian Jamshid. Let me just give a few remarks about the name and the fame of this figure. We can start with Yama, which in three related languages and ethnic groups is represented in Vedic, the oldest kind of Sanskrit, let us say, by the name Yama. Also in Nuristani, which is a very archaic language old Iranian, we reconstruct again Yama, and this is actually attested in old Persian, where our source act in Elamite, actually, where we have reflection of his full name, Yama Shaita. I mean, Yama is his name, but sometimes he's also, we have the additional epithet Shaita. So this together, Yama Shaita, gives us Persian Jamshid, older Jamshid, or Yama simply Jam, as he's also known. Now, in Avesta, the oldest corpus of Zoroastrianism, we have him known as Yima. And in the oldest Avestan, Yima, we would expect Yima, but because of the influence of later Avestan, since old Avestan occurs within a matrix of younger Avestan, he's Yima. That hardly matters, except I should mention that the name spelled, the word spelled as Yima does occur in its basic meaning twin. It occurs in another poem other than the one I'm talking about, again in the Gathas of Zarathustra, where there's reference to the twin spirits. In Zarathustra's religious conception, at the beginning there were two spirits, and one chose for good, one chose for evil, but the interesting thing is he calls them twin. And I think I've discovered why he calls them twin, because in the very interesting compositional methodology of Zarathustra, which I hope to have discovered, each poem is the basis of another poem, that poem is the basis of another poem, and so forth and so on. I'll show you some examples of this in the course of my talk. Thank you. But it's rather interesting to know that it's because this poem, which mentions Yima, came in compositional sequence before the poem in which Zarathustra laid out his scheme of the origin of things. In the methodological recasting, stanza by stanza, of the earlier poem, he said, here is Yemat, means twin, I'll call them the twin spirits. An interesting little side point of no relevance to my main talk. It is somewhat relevant to give the etymology of Yama from a root, Yam, which, as we see from other examples, and from Sanskrit and so forth, and to some extent from Indo-European too, especially Baltic, the basic idea is to put together this kind of motion, to clasp together. So if you think of two twins related so, then this root applies. I mention this because it will be of some relevance in the course of what I have to say. And with regard to the multifaceted aspect of Yima, within Iran, he is connected with the underworld, he's connected with propagation of the world, the renewal of the world, with many fine things, and also an interesting relationship with his twin sister. As in Vedic, he has a twin sister. How this twinship plays out, twinship of siblings plays out, is different in Iran and ancient India. It's a question of whether the two mate. In India, they don't. In Iran, they do. That's yet another matter of the twinship of Yama. immortal. After ruling in a golden age, he undergoes a fall, and death comes into the world at that point. He has a multifarious connection with death in Vedic India. He was, as a matter of fact, ruler of the dead. And one can go on, but that will serve just to indicate what a complex figure this is, both heroic and, one may say, anti-heroic. Now, I hope you all have a handout in front of you. In Roman 1, I give my approach to Yima in this particular poem, Yasna 32, which is one of 17 canonical poems which form the Gathas. Never mind the numbering means nothing, but it is one of 17 poems. I look at the structure. Now, you can look at the structure yourself if you will see the inner part of the last page of the handout. You see, this is a concentric construction, so that the first and last stanzas are related by words common to them. And as we'll see in the left-hand diagram, the center, in the center, which was stanzas 8 and 9, that's where we get our Yima. And there are connections between the center of the poem, where Yima, as it were, lives in the poem, and the two at the front, the beginning and the end of the poem. But this is not focused on Yima, even though Yima is focused, so to speak, in the poem. But I'm just showing the concentric scheme. Actually, there are two such schemes. The first scheme, a poem of 13 stanzas, and still symmetrical, and then it was enlarged by 3 stanzas, and so you get a larger poem with a symmetry, and here's the finalizing coda. That is all we need to say for now about the structure of the poem in terms of ring composition. All of the poems show such structures. And then part of my structural approach is the systematic compositional relationship of Yasna 32 with other Gothic poems, especially Yasna 48, 53, 46, 49, and 30, according to the scheme I mentioned before. One poem generates another, so you get all kinds of similarities from poem to poem, quite systematic similarities, works mechanically, in a way. Curious thing that Zarathustra not only thought thematically, but he thought in very interesting compositional schemes. He didn't have to. He did, perhaps it's not a challenge, I'm not sure why, he used these complex ways for us to discover them eventually, as I hope to have done, and perhaps for God, for his divinity, to appreciate the complexity of the poetic gift that he was giving mankind on behalf of his divinity, Mazda Ahura. Style. The style is enigmatic, it's tricky. It has the taste of a riddle, with intentional ambiguity, so double and triple seems that there is divinized beverage home, obfuscation, hubris, and ties which entrap. The Halma cult, that the Halma cult is involved here, is not obvious, but I'll show that it is. And hubris is the key to the downfall of Yima. Now, under ambiguity, I, in Roman 2, give you the first stanza of the poem, A, B, C, the first of the three lines which constitute the stanza. Well, you can translate this in a number of ways, and it was meant to be perceived in a number of ways. At first, it looks as though it means his family. Is so to speak erased, and you get a new kind of overall interpretation. So the family requests, the community with tribe request, at my, namely Zarathustra's, prompting, the demons, or oh you demons. So is he talking about the demons, or is he talking to the demons? Now, from a viewpoint of grammar, since you have a combination of the word ahya, his, meaning Ahura Mazda's, as it turns out, plus another noun in three different combinations. In the second line, line B, ahya daiwa, the word daiwa should not be, as some people suspect, an address form, hey, you demons, but it should be part of the narrative, just as family, community, and tribe request the bliss of Mazda Ahura, so do the demons. And then you have a statement which can be taken in two ways. When the righteous parties say it, it means we shall be your messengers holding back your enemies. But when we are to understand that the demons and their supporters, who are in their own way also demons, that can be shown textually, say the same words, we shall be smokes to Ahura Mazda, upholding or holding fast your enemies, meaning holding in our embrace. So messengers versus smokes, holding back versus upholding, and that is the trick of the demons. They seem to say one thing, but they really mean something quite different. And I give the chief ambiguities here, the word daiwa, which I've already discussed as to whether it's an address form or a nominative narrative form. Duta, messenger, and or smoke. The Iranians among you will know the word dud, smoke. Duta, also in Vedic, is messenger. Dari, in the plural daria, holding can mean either restraining, there should be an S there. The amanuensis who prepared this handout needs retraining severely, but the word should be restraining or maintaining and even embracing. Now, there are two, there's a kind of double address that Zarathustra makes in answer to this request for his bliss. The word bliss is an important word. So, to those, Mazda Ahura, who is connected with a good mind and who is the close associate of Sunny Rightness, speaks back, as a response from his divinity. We choose your holy harmonious thought, may it be ours. So here, in the third stanza, he speaks to those with sincere intent who want to hold back his enemies and also the enemies of his two associates to close associates, best rightness and good mind. That's why there is a singular thee and a plural your. It's a bit of a theological trick, so to speak. He gives you both. He tells you there's Ahura Mazda, who has two close associates. So Mazda Ahura in Zarathustra's thought is both singular and plural. Let me step back for a moment and say what I must, that these poems are exceedingly complex and were meant to be so because he was interested not only in communicating his ideas straightforwardly, but having an inner group of associates, of patrons. He needed to show how he was qualified as a representative of Mazda Ahura. And these audiences, as is seen from Vedic poems do, often were presented with things that they had to figure out. And I think some of his followers, while they were people of great power, were no dummies. They were intellectually engaged people. Let me also say that these poems were composed in a period before writing. They were handed down generation after generation for many, many centuries, even after people knew what they were. They were remembered pretty accurately the words, and so the poems were handed down for centuries into the period when there was not only literacy, but literacy was so dominant that the priesthood were worried that the material will no longer be remembered, so it was committed to writing, probably in the late Sasanian period, sometime in the Sasanian period anyway. Okay, in Roman 4 you get the answer to the other group, but you, demons all, are in your lineage, or clearly, there's an example of the two meanings, each of them is justifiable, and I won't go through that. You are in your lineage, for you are clearly from bad mind, from wrongness, and from perverse thought, as well as is your chief worshippers. Further, duplicitous are the doings you've been heard, or you can fame of the earth. Duplicitous. Speak with doubleness, with dupleness, you know? So duplicity. And that is a key to the speech of the demons. They speak in a double way. And there you have, within the ring compositional scheme, the original ring compositional scheme, Roman numeral 5, there's also another address which has the words, to those Mazda speaks. To those Mazda speaks bad things. So within the symmetry of the poem, there's a second answer to the bad group. For that fame or speech for which those people deflect mortals from the best action, who divert the cow's life by means of the oath for bliss. What is the oath for bliss? May we be thy messengers of smoke. To hold back or hold up, whatever. But that is in the beginning of the poem, the object of that is getting the bliss, the happy state from Mazda Ahura. And we see that that is the behavior of the false priests. Next. Here I give, by the way, the phrase oath of bliss, which our text has Urwash Uchti, should really be Urwash Uchti within our manuscript tradition. Urwash and Urwash get confused. The part Uchti, like Armenian Ucht, is bliss, is an oath. And Urwaz is the word for this variant of the form that we saw at the beginning of the poem, or was. And I'll continue with the next stanzas. Through this domination, namely the domination of the evil parties, the priests and their patrons, oppression ties down the destroyers of this existence to hell, as also those, O Mazda, who complain again and again in their greed against either the messenger or the smoke of your poet, which would keep them or protect them from the sight of rightness. And there is a relative pronoun, yeah, which means either who or which. And what does it refer to? Does it refer to the masculine noun kama, or to the masculine noun mantran poet, or to the word duta, also masculine, which means messenger or smoke? The answer is really, I mean, in the world that Zoroaster would like us to understand, it is their greed which keeps them back from seeing rightness, even though they complain that Zoroaster or his messengers keep them from rightness. Their own greed keeps them from seeing. So that's another instance of ambiguity where we are to understand that there is a truth and a false representation implicit here. And through this oppression, the oppression of this existence, the warlords put their intellects and their splendors into entrapment via the porum, hicha, as Jost Gippelt did a good job of showing, I think, difficult sequence of warcha hicha in the original. What is this pouring? Something is being poured. As they, these evil ones, position themselves downwards for the deceitful one, for the devil. While saying is made that the cow is to be killed, who burns, namely by the one who burns, the Durausha. Durausha is an epithet, it's the fixed term for Hauma in the hymn to the plant drink god Hauma. And the word awo is repeated, and I think in the first instance it means downwards. They're descending into hell, as already said, and as is made clear later. And they burn this Durausha plant as help. Now, in 1989, I co-authored a work called Hauma and Harmland with someone named Flattery, David S. Flattery, F-L-A-T-T-E-R-Y. Most of the book is, I mean, I think all of it is online by now if you Google. There we came out with a hypothesis that the psychotropic plant behind the Hauma cult is a plant botanically known as Paganum harmala, whence the Arabic word harmal, harmal in English, and I think harmal in German too. Iranians know this plant not for its psychoactive effects, but because they burn it to keep away evil spirits and envy at festive occasions. This is the plant which in Persian is called Isfand or Sepand and so forth. And the seeds of the plant are burned. The smoke is thick and pungent, and this is the motif of smoke which occurs in conjunction with this verse. I give you some words for the plant in Roman numeral 8 that refer to smoke and making smoke. And the interesting thing is, etymologically, the word isfand is the only remnant, the only single word remnant of the ancient word for, gross motto, we can say, holy, spanfenefest. Another thing of interest before I get to my into the thick this moment, the thick of the poem, is the word urwasma. The word urwasma, bliss, which is the object of the first thought, occurs several times in very interesting ways. It refers to a state of happiness in the afterlife. So in the verse that I give you here, Yasna 49, at the end of Roman numeral 9 in the handout, we see again words that, in terms of poetry, are very much like words we find in that first stanza. The word for request, the word for connected, and a number of other themes, and most importantly, a form of the word for bliss. Zarathustra asks that a connection with bliss be established, the most blissful aspect of rightness for his patron, for Shaustra, and for himself. That do I request of thee, Master, who are forever shall we be thy emissaries. Instead of messengers here, emissaries. So you see this is formulaically related to the first stanza of Yasna 32. And it emphasizes how important this word, or was, or wasma, or whatever form you have, is for Zarathustra's thought and for what he presents in his poetry. Now, in Roman numeral 10, we have yet another poem, Yasna 33, which says, in effect, whoever opposes evil by word, thought, or action, or recognizes the guest by goodness, this is a kind of definition of piety, those or these achieve Ahura Mazda's will, and will be in his favor. So there you have the afterlife, the idea of bliss, and then, in fact, yes, at the end of Romans, numeral 10, where I give kind of reconstructive phonetic transcription of that phrase, Warai radanti ahrakia zarshai mazda'a. I can recite these by repeating these words in such a way that at the end you get the word urwasma, which is essentially the word, the later form of the word, urwasma is the basic form of the word for bliss that we encountered in the beginning of the poem. So finally, Razma. So this is an oral acrostic which encodes where it is to be expected for poetic reasons the word for bliss that we have at the beginning. So what's the big deal with this word bliss that Zarathustra is so preoccupied with it? Well, if we look at Yasna 10.8, which is not part of the Gothic corpus, but which is part of a poem called roughly the Home Yasht, people give it other names, but it is an ancient praise, ancient liturgy, to the plant liquid god Hauma. In that text it says, all other intoxications are accompanied by fury with the gory club. Mm-hmm. So other ways of getting intoxicated, involve violence according to this poem, but Helmer's intoxication is accompanied by bliss. Urwasman equals the older form, Urwasman. So what the Helmer cult is saying is that through this plant, you get bliss. Zarathustra didn't like that. He must have had some experience as a priest with that plant. And that plant, if we're right in saying that the psychoactive aspect of it was the isfand, which can bring on nausea and diarrhea, he didn't like it, and he probably didn't like it theologically. He had his own theological vision. And now, if indeed we look at Yasna 32:10, moving up to the center of the poem, we have that man indeed diverts words or fame. He who swears by the worst thing, or who swears that the worst thing is to see the sun and cow, or who swears the worst thing in order to see the sun and cow, with his evil eyes, a special word for an eye of an evil person, who makes the lawful ones into wrongsome ones, and who upturns the pastures and lifts the weapon against the righteous. Now, most of the words in this stanza occur in the Haumiasht, the Hauma hymn, in only a sequence of three stanzas, 29, 30, and 31. You get parallels of all of these words, some of which are quite rare words, like the word wadar and the word voida. So that it appears that Zarathustra knew the original form of the Hauma hymn, didn't like it, and is doing a sort of word jazz parody. People who would know that hymn would hear the echo of it. And that is my textual evidence for Zarathustra having known the Hauma hymn and being concerned with it. Now, the way that stanza begins, if you pronounce it in the Avestan, Hauma, that man indeed, or that man as far as I'm concerned, Hauma na, sounds like Hauma through Hauma. He did not want to preserve the name of Hauma overtly, but he preserved it as a pun, as a word, through this process of ambiguity that I mentioned earlier. Literally, the word Hauma means extracted by a mortar and pestle. You pound the plant with a pestle and a mortar, and you add liquid to it, and it becomes more vivid if you add ephedra in the mortar. Mortared ephedra by itself has no effects. If you boil it, well, it's a mild stimulant, but it's not psychoactive in any event, and certainly not in the mortared form. After, I think, Zarathustra castigated the use of this particular plant as Hauma, the other Hauma plant, which was probably used as an auxiliary, namely ephedra, took over as the ephedra plant through history. Now, again, the compositional scheme. Yasna 32, going backwards in that poem from stanza 16 to stanza 12, gives you Yasna 48, another Gothic poem. 7 to its end in 48:12. Very specific words are repeated, including a whole phrase, Yehemaithishtwaitha. We needn't go through what they mean, but if you chart these two, you see that there is a relationship between this section of Yasna 48 and this sequence backwards, remember the sequence of Yasna 42. And it is here get this famous verse, which I translate as, when will they beat down the feces of Muthra? It does not mean urine. When will they beat down the feces of that intoxication, together with which, in their wickedness, the Karapan priests, Zarathustra's rivals, cause, or either themselves suffer, racking vomiting. And indeed, Humbach and Puchel before him translated this as involving some kind of spastic, unpleasant vomiting. Before in Romans, we see that not only one, but actually two verses in the Ayurveda, others have noted the first instance, that mada, intoxication, plus the root rup in various forms, as we have it in our poem, refers to an intoxication which produces visceral racking, throwing up, as it were. That is in the Rig Veda, that is in the Vedic material, which sometimes provide interesting parallels for the Iranian materials. Professor Sadovsky has shown in a number of publications. And the word ajan has a parallel with the prefix a plus the rujan to beat. In the language of West Iran today, in the area of Dilijan, and paganum harmala, can produce, as I said, diarrhea and vomiting. That is, fan plant produces, can produce diarrhea and vomiting because of its psychoactive chemicals, harming and harmaline. This is known to Perso-Arabic pharmacopoeias, and these plants are contained, these drugs are contained in another plant which is used in the Amazon. Not Asteriopsis copy or yahe or ayahuasca. Those effects are found again. Now, we go to, again, to the Halmiasht. Halma, righteous Halma, Durosha, the son of Huiwanhua, was awarded to his father, was born to his father, as his father's gift for being the first Halm oppressor. Let me say that again. Yima was born to be the son of this guy with one point as reward to that first oppressor of Halm. What boon did he get? He got Yima, according to this Halma text. Romans 17. Then we have, we come to the stanza involving Halma himself. Two stanzas before it begins, many uncountable are the violations whereby one gains fame, namely through false speech, one gets a reputation, as we saw in the beginning of the poem, with the false priests and their followers. O reckoner of things which are earned, Ahura, thou knowest with best mind. In short, Zarathustra, in short, Ahura Mazda does an accounting of one's earnings, one's merits. Of those violations goes the next stanza, and the Yima, the son of Huiwanhua, was heard or famed, who, wishing in reciprocity and as cultic satisfaction, this is the root shnu, which doesn't mean merely to satisfy, but it means to satisfy in reciprocity, and is used with regard to cultic, that is to say, worship relations between the worshiper and the divinity. It's a system of quid pro quo, the worshiper gives the divinity gives the worshiper, just as the host gives to the guest, and the guest in future is expected to give to the host. You have this institution with a cognate word. In fact, I indicated that the root chshnu is goes back to the Indo-European root whence xenia, xenuia, in archaic Greek, the institution of reciprocal gift giving comes. This stanza 8 ends with Zarathustra saying, "If I'm guilty of such violations, O Master, that isn't thy decision." That phrase is quite significant, because in the poem in which, according to this recasting from one poem to another, it's based, Yasna 46:18, in exactly the corresponding verse, promises requitals, reciprocities in kind for both good and bad treatment to Zarathustra and his followers. And here Zarathustra says, "Thus am I propitiating," or requiting, again the root chshnu, "your will, Master Hura. That is the decision of my intellect and my mind." So here Zarathustra can be accused of some arrogance. In the name of Master Hura, he says, "That's my decision to give requitals in your name." And I think he was a little sensitive about that, lest he be accused of hubris, because in Yasna 49, number 3 in the handout, he says, "I am merely wishing to reciprocatively satisfy Chikshnusha," the same word we saw in the Gatha, "to satisfy the poorly herded ones with rightness, O Master." In other words, just look, I'm doing this just to help out people who need guidance. It's important that the word chichnusha in the Gathas and in later Avesta refers to relationship between worshipper and divinity. So, 20, number 1, that's my point. The word bhaga should mean via a god. The word gaush can be shown to mean to miss the goal, to go astray, to fall. It's very nice that the Khwarezmian word gauda corresponds to Arabic akhta'a in the Persian translation of that Khwarezmian dictionary in which the word occurs is gumshod, he went lost. And finally, the word khwaremno, as I indicated before, has cognates with the word khwar, means to swear in various Iranian languages. It is important that khwar means swear, because the word khwaremno has been thought to refer to eating, and that the word gaush means a cow, and that baga means a portion. Actually, Helmut Humbach saw quite a long time ago another interpretation, partially like mine here, but at the end of the day, thought that Yima went astray with something to do with meat, which is a proper and satisfying meal. If you look at 2010, Helmut Humbach translation of the Gathas. But there are problems, linguistic problems of that, and I think this translation that I offer here, I hope I offer it here, Yima, again in 19, wishes to satisfy the mortals by means of a god and by swearing himself, middle voice, Varenna. So that is very important. He wants to satisfy the mortals of his time by means of a divinity. indeed there was, indeed the god Yima in his various forms, is known in Bactria and to some extent in Sogdiana to have been worshipped as a god. Franz Kolnay has given plenty of evidence for that. So there were areas in which Yima was worshipped as a god in pre-Islamic Iran. Now, let's go back to Yima's fault in Yasht 1935. The glory departed from Yima, the son of Wiwankwa. He spoke a lie, draugen, in Persian druch, if you know Persian druch, even if you don't, it still means that. That's an example. A rhetorical figure, never mind. discuss that with Olga earlier. So, what lie did he speak? Why don't you word? Well, it's by swearing he was a god, according to my interpretation of the Yasna. What is interesting is that the texts in which Yima is positive, is a positive figure, name his father as Wiwahwant. That is the basic stem. Exactly as we have Vivasvant in the Rig Veda, what we call ant stem, like Persian ande, participial form. However, in the Gathas and in Yasna 19, where Yima is clearly negative, the form of the name of the father has to be reconstructed as something which you can set up as either Wiwankwan or Wiwankwa or what have you, but it is like the word widwa, a perfect participle, and not an active participle, rather past perfect participle. He who has done, well, I should say perfect, he who has done away. So whereas Wiwakwant means he who is radiant, Wiwankwa, genitive Wiwankusho, like Widusho from Widwa, perfect participle, would mean he who was radiant, and the implication is, but has now faded. So he somehow lost his glory like the sun. Why? Because he pressed Hamun. Moreover, one can break up by means of a pun that form Wiwankusha as who has achieved or earned that root hung, that figure several times in adjacent stanzas in this poem. He who has achieved Wiwanku, that which is other than good, that which is not good. In other words, he's achieved the good for nothing, Yima. That's what he is. I'm not saying this means this, but as a kind of wordplay, you can get that meaning, and that can be justified not only linguistically, but if you look at, let us see if we have the right chart. Yes, chart 5, the last page of the handout. Here you see the relationship between Yasna 32 and Yasna 53. Very systematic. And for Yasna 38a, we have one who show, you have the sequence. Should be an ellipsis between the two words here. We weng hatu hu shanam, where hu shanam means the good earning from the root han, becomes shan after an u, or is maintained as shan. But you have a word like we one point followed by good earning, compositionally related. And if you look at the next line, you see yimaschit gives you. Perhaps Yim and Ayese. Ayese is again from the root. So the father is rebuked along with the son for the Halma cult. And The stanza 9, which adjoins stanza 8, according to the ring compositional scheme, has to be related. They say 8 and 9 are the two central stanzas of the poem, and they always show some kind of verbal connection. And in this case, you have the word for rob. He indeed robs the welcome achievement, and the word for achievement. Apayamta, he robbed. Apayanta from apayamta. That is cognate with yama, from the root yam to clasp, or to hold on to, as I said at the beginning. And hati, the earning, is cognate with that sha element from the root han, to earn, or to achieve. So that the two central stanzas bear out my explanation of a kind of wordplay that Zarathustra gives for the name of Yima's father. So here we have the background, now I'm coming to my conclusion, of Ferdowsi and other writers of the early Islamic period, that Jam or Jamshid declared himself God, declared himself the creator of the world, and wanted people to worship him. You have it, I think, first in the 9th or 10th century in the Pahlavi work, the Pahlavi Revoyat of the goddess Fana Denig. And there you have, in effect, Ahriman the devil and Deves the demons make Jam or Jamshid think that he's God. Then we find this a little later on, next century and following, in Farsnome and of course in Shahnome, where Jamshid requires to be treated as, requires of people that they treat him as God, and also the oath of Ba'ami gives a similar story. So in the early Islamic period, it seems, if I'm right, and if long ago Humbach's suspicion, not in the Humbach translations of the last few decades, but such credit must be given to Humbach that he glimpsed some of this, that the hubris of Yima and the report of his wishing to be worshipped is found in Shahnameh, and as I say, I have also found the Pahlavi Revoyat and Farsnameh and Balami have the same story. And in my title, Poetics, Linguistics, Mythology, and Memory, well, of course, I confess to liking the alliteration mythology and memory, but memory is at issue here, because what is the vehicle whereby this very, very, very archaic story, which does not occur in the entirety of the Pahlavi literature before the Islamic period. We have many commentaries in Pahlavi and Zoroastrian Middle Persian, on the Gathas and on the Avesta. And as far as the Yima story goes, yes, Jamshid is there, but he eats meat and he has cows killed or whatever, and again, they focus on this business of meat eating. So it's an interesting question. We don't have textual evidence for the maintenance of this idea from the very archaic period to the early Islamic period. transmitted through folklore? I have to say yes, and I must admit to my surprise, because I think that, you know, folkloric memory goes only so far. Others may romanticize and think that, oh, you know, people remember things for centuries. But do they? I doubted it, but now I wonder. And so this issue of memory becomes very interesting in this whole matter. And there you have my thoughts. I hope I haven't run on too long on Zoroaster's Yima and Ferdowsi's Jamshid, the poetics, the linguistics, the mythology, and memory. And I thank you for your attention. If you look, for example, at my article, if anyone wants, I can forward them an online copy, in the Wiley Blackwell Companion to Zoroastrian Literature, I've taken that first stanza and have shown that there is a complex encoding of Zarathustra's theology, and it's really cognitively exceedingly astounding, but I didn't want to take up with it. With that here, I've already discussed it sufficiently.
Yeah. Also, another aspect that maybe was a bit unsettled, but the aspect of performance, how important that is for the understanding, that so that the recitation of the actual performing of the would really create another layer of meaning the way you recite it, as you showed in some instances. So, and of course, the final point that you make is absolutely intriguing, and I think it's one of the, should be one of the big questions that are too rarely asked about the memory of and the transmission, and also the diversity of the religious traditions that we may not always see. And I think this is. Also, for me, something that I take from this talk very much, this connection you make between this very old, ancient, archaic reflection, and this reflection in the early Islamic literature may not be coincidental, but it's in the Fars Nama, who knows if it's a regional thing or more than that. But that's it's an open question, but I think it's a very important one. I'm definitely not an expert in this field, so I open the floor to questions from especially
well, thank you so much. Beside sound patterns, beside encoded visions, beside a religion which structures itself within a very short text, you showed it perfectly, but this of course has been your specialty in the course of four decades, so this is a step forward, but the main step forward for me is now that you show clearly that what Yima did was not saying a lie. What you did was saying, doing a wrongness in your terms of Druj and of Asha being rightness and wrongness. And this is completely different, which changes the paradigm in which we have to think about the primordial sin of Yima. Our French colleagues did a symposium 2 years ago about Yima, inviting Kenneth Antonio Panino, Samra Zarnush, and Jean Pinot talking about all the time about the lie. There is no lie in what you show to us now, but it is the wrongness of projecting yourself on the level of the divine, so to say, hubris in its etymological sense, like trying to be superior as than you are. Yeah, and I think this is an extremely important pattern of thinking in which we have to go ahead, and it is really the summit of the iceberg, because when you speak about young Imre, yeah, and Yama Raja. Of course, this is this idea of the sacred royalty, which Zarathustra is strictly against. Zarathustra is a dissident among priests, but he's also a dissident on the priestly part against the ruling, let's not say caste, but class of kshatriyas, and shows that, well, if there is any sacredness in royalty, it's not in worldly royalty, but it's in the divine one. So it's basically, I think, the most important structural element you showed us, and which lacked till now no interpretations of this passage, because if the Vedic gods, the devas, become demons, we have to remember that Yama Raja is a god, yeah, who originally was the primordial twin of Manu, but who explicitly wanted to be a deva and ended up in hell, in the underworld, in the yonder world, but in the opposite part of the yonder world. So basically, it is a double kick against his own contemporary ruling caste, trying to identify itself with the sacred royalty of something that was strictly against, and against the old demons, against the devas, on the plan of Yama. Would you like to develop the Vivasvant element and Vivasvant metaphor? Because also in the Greek mythology, Manu and Yama are sons of Vivasvant. What you are saying now about the participle, Norbert Oettinger said something like 5 months ago on the conference in honor of Sasha Lobotsky. He is publishing it in his Fast Shift. It is exactly your order of thoughts, that it means something that has happened in the past.
Mm.
Past perfect, so I think perhaps you should contact Norbert about that. But what does it mean that we have two primordial humans, one of which wanted to overstep into the divine and was punished, or that the father already had a primordial sin, so
mm-hmm.
primordial minus one, and this idea was then continued in one of the sons, the second one being the righteous one and the first one being the wrong one.
Well, thank you, Dr. Sadowski, for thought-provoking remarks. I should make only 3 points, one of which I've forgotten. But the conference that you mentioned, quite apart from Antonio Panayino's individual publications, is now out, has been out for a while. The editors being Samra Osavnush and Selina Bada, and that's a very interesting prolegomenon, introduction to yamology, so to speak. The point of the daiwa is something I didn't get into, but the problem, background of the problem is that deva in Vedic Sanskrit, and the equivalent term in Nuristani means god, daiwa means a demon. Same word. Now, it's clear that the god is the older meaning, means heavenly one, from really related to the word for sky. Many people think that there was a kind of relationship, a kind of balance between a category of gods called daivas and a category of gods called ahuras, and that Zarathustra, second idea is that Zarathustra himself took the word, traditional word for god, and demoted it to mean divinity. I don't think, to mean demon, I don't think that is the case. Because I was able, through my work on the proto-form of the Hamyash, to show that daiwa and daiwodata and so forth are pre-Zarathustrian terms in the sense of a demon. The reason I think Zarathustra uses the word daiwa generically for a demon is he does not want to name and keep alive the fame of evil parties. So the formulation angramainu for the devil, the evil spirit, is not found in the Gathas. he plays around with it in various phonological and lexical variations, but you don't find the devil named. And you don't find, you find, for example, Angra-Magnet is thought to be evil, but not Angra-Magnet. And as I indicated, you don't find Hauma, but you find the wordplay, Hauma, followed by extractions of words from the Hauma-Yasht. So he gets around it that way. So it's not that Dai was under Zarathustra's preaching were demoted. That's another problem. I suggest that because there was a multiplicity of words for divinities, and especially since there was kind of competition, as I showed a long time ago, with the religion of Nuristan, which was known to the Avesta in detail way back, and perhaps also at the period of co-terminus location of the Vedic, pre-Vedic culture and the Iranians. It was competition, sociological and ultimately theological, I think. The word that got used a lot by one group got demoted, just as we see the word ashi, which occurs in this poem, for an evil eye, is in Sanskrit akshi, and various cognate forms in the Nuristani language, quite neutral word for eye, and one can go on from there. So thank you very much for your remarks.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? If not, we can also continue this. We have a few refreshments here just in the other room over there, and we'll then continue after that with the presentation of the recent publication, and which I think Martin and Fonse agreed to say a few words.
With pleasure.
Which is very, very kind of you. So, but I think even more so, you deserve some refreshment right now before that we reconvene at, let's say, at a quarter to 7 just yet. Thank you very much.